Michael. Senators changing. Jack down the right side. Works himself to the front of the net. Wrap around attempt. Jack Michael scores a beautiful goal, and the Buffalo Sabres on the power play have tied the game at two.
He makes it happen. You see him take the puck down the left wall. Can't get to the net. Hangs onto it. And he's so good at going from one side to the other.
What's up, you hockey nuts? It's Tony Adonucci with Playmakers Hockey. In today's video, we'd like to cover some of the foundations of skating mechanics, as well as some considerations for some basic training that'll help translate to those on-ice skating mechanics. So the way we're going to do this, we'd like to start with some still frames of some elite skaters in both their straightaway strides as well as some edging situations. And then we'd like to move on to some of the common mechanical attributes that contribute to their elite performance, and then discuss some off-ice physical attributes and their associations to on-ice performance. For example, like, what are the measurements we're taking off-ice in training in order to predict on-ice performance, and what those actual tests and numbers are telling us, and how to prioritize them to see what is actually predicting on-ice success. And then we like to go through some basic considerations that you might want to make with respect to developing your own training. So let's get started with some of these still frames. So I'd like to work from the ground up. So we're going to take a look at the foot and ankle complex first. Okay, so in this situation, what we're looking for is appropriate ankle dorsiflexion, and all that means is the forward flex at the ankle. And you can see Jack has lots of it. And if you look closely at the skate, for clear this, you look closely at that skate, he leaves that top eyelet open. So that's something we might discuss later, but something to consider in order to achieve this ankle dorsiflexion. And we'll talk about this later, but if you don't have that, you can't put enough force into the ice and get into the next component, which is going to be appropriate knee flexion and hip flexion to generate power into that ice surface. So you might want to consider tweaking the way that you tie your skates in order to achieve that appropriate flex at the ankle. And obviously there's going to be some physical restrictions there outside of just playing around with your skates. But I've seen plenty of times over the years where players just, they have their skates tied way too tight in those top two eyelets, and they don't nearly get enough flex to get over the balls of their feet in order to generate power into the ice. So something you want to consider. And as we just mentioned, we're going to take a look at that knee flexion ability. So elite skaters, they're able to get enough flexion at the ankle and enough flexion at the knee to achieve this deep sit position. And the players that are able to achieve that deeper sit position and work from that position longer are the ones that really separate themselves. And the final couple things we're going to look at is hip, knee, and ankle extension. And actually, ankle extension is just what we're talking about is called plantar flexion. But we're just looking to see how far we can extend the hip to achieve that nice stride length and get that full power and maximize each push into the ice. And then the other thing we're looking at is upper body positioning with relate and how it relates to lower body. And all I like to do is take a look at this straight line from head to heel. And if we're achieving that, we're probably in a pretty good position. So if we quickly go from Jack's college picture on to the next one, we're going to see if we can see a theme here. So the theme right away, foot and ankle complex, right? Achieving that nice ankle dorsiflexion to generate power from the ice up. Nice deep knee bend to achieve that sit position. Okay. And then nice full hip extension, getting that big stride length, and then head to heel, right? And what I love about this is right here, he's got the eyes up and he's achieving these mechanics both with the puck and if you go back without the puck. So you want to make sure you're keeping those same basic mechanics both with and without. On to the next one, Nathan MacKinnon. Okay, probably the most explosive skater in today's game. And let's take a look. This one's a little bit different angle, but you're still going to be able to see those same themes. So foot and ankle complex, getting a nice bend there, good dorsiflexion. A nice deep sit position. Okay. Good knee flexion, good hip flexion. And then that nice long hip extension, knee extension, and then plantar flexion to finish through the ice. And then one thing we'd like to note, this is great that we're able to compare him to a teammate here. Some of the difference is going to come from the angle that we're viewing and the fact that Nathan's in front of his teammate. But what I'd like to point out is because he's able to achieve that deep sit position, his core is already going to be lower than his opponent's, and he's going to be able to generate way more power than the guy skating next to him. And oftentimes, this is the subtle difference between a puck battle won and a puck battle lost, or gaining that extra inch of ice necessary to make a play. So if we keep rolling to the next one, MacKinnon again. Okay, so keeping with that theme, we want to do it with and without the puck. With the puck in this one. Okay, we've got some good dorsiflexion. Now he's not planted in the ice anymore, but you're still going to see that same thing of a nice deep flexion at the ankle, achieving that solid deep sit position in the knee and hip, and then good hip extension, putting that power into the ice. And then this particular clip is a great look of something we want to consider off the ice, and that's the ability not only to dorsiflex at the ankle, but also to evert and be able to get into this 45 degree angle or even deeper to maximize the edges of our skates to get into the ice and get that nice hard push every time. So something we want to consider off the ice is different scenarios to achieve that in order to train those muscles to be able to push off like that at the foot and ankle complex. And one that comes to mind is a real simple one. It's been around for a long time, but the slide board. Slide board is an excellent tool because you get out of it what you put into it in every push, and you're also able to achieve that nice angular push off. Go to the next one. Okay, so we're getting to some of these still frames and of using our edges and not just our straightaway strides. So again, elite level players are able to achieve that sit position. So right away, let's undo that one. So right away, we're looking here, able to achieve that nice deep sit position. Okay, but what I want to get into now is a theme we like to call anchoring the shoulders. Okay, so if we take a look at the hips and the way the lower body is achieving this nice deep angle to utilize those edges in the ice, we now have to be able, as an elite skater, you've got to be able to separate what your lower body and your upper body are doing. Okay, so Crosby's got this nice deep angle, but he's also got level shoulders, and he's able to rotate his upper body into his turn. And what you love to see with this one too is he's able to do that all with his eyes up and rotating and processing at the same time. But that shoulder anchor, right, to be able to anchor that outside shoulder, level them out, and still allow your lower body to do that work to get out of that turn. Okay, so let's take a look and see if we can find that in the next one. Okay, Matt Barzell in the fastest skater competition. Again, look at the angle of the hips, angle of the lower body using his edges, okay? But now he's able to counterbalance and offset that angle by keeping those shoulders level and anchoring that outside shoulder. I believe we got one more to see if we can find this theme again. Connor McDavid, engaged in battle here. Again, undo again, lower body lean, lower body angle, using those edges and being able to separate lower body from upper body, keeping level shoulders. Okay, you'll see a lot of stuff on the internet these days of coaches running drills where they want you to lean all the way into the circles and skate the circles or even get down on the elbows. Just as a reminder, the only thing they're teaching you is to feel how far you can go on those edges and push it to the extreme to feel the edges. They are not or should not be teaching you to lean in to the middle of that circle during your turns. You should be counterbalancing, and this is proof right here. So let's move on to the next one. So what we're going to do here is we want to get into some of the considerations for off-ice physical qualities and metrics, and all that means is measurements, off-ice tests, and their association to on-ice performance. And this should be our guide. And this should be our guide when considering what we are doing off the ice to improve our on-ice performance and our skating specifically. Okay, so the studies have shown that the number one predictor of an off-ice quality that translates to on-ice performance is off-ice speed. Okay, number one. So what does that mean? If you're fast, if you're fast off the ice, odds are you're probably going to be pretty fast on the ice. And the way that we achieve that is through short or medium length sprints. So what we mean is 10-yard sprints up to maybe 40-yard sprints or meters. But those short bursts, right, that's going to replicate the demands on ice. Honestly, you should be doing this 2-3 days a week at least to maintain speed. So the easiest way to increase your speed is to run fast and do it often, okay? Next one, lower body power. So that the test that we're talking about would be vertical as well as broad jump, so jump measurements. That's the number two biggest indicator of on-ice performance. Okay, so knowing these top two right off the bat, is that matching up with what you're doing off the ice right now? Okay, are we focusing on mirror muscles? Are we focusing entirely on body composition or going out for a couple mile run? I mean, you really want to consider what you're doing. Okay, so as we go down this list, we'll just blast through this quickly just so we can cover them all. But peak and mean power, so the Wingate cycle test, if you're unfamiliar with that, it's the one in the combine where the guys are on the bike. It's basically you versus your own body weight, and they're measuring maximum power and how long you can sustain that power. Okay, lower body strength, right? And what we're talking about there is heavily loaded knee flexion exercises or knee dominant exercises such as heavy squat or split squat. Upper body strength, heavy pushing and pulling, both body weight and external load type exercises. So your push-ups, your chin-ups, your bench press, your rows, stuff like that. Off-ice agility. Okay, for example, the test that they always use for that would be your 20-yard pro agility shuttle. Everyone's done that in gym class and everywhere else. Core strength, okay, all the way down to number 7. We want to discuss that real quick. Okay, core strength is still vitally important, even though it is down the list as far as association to on-ice performance. That one right there is gonna be a critical one as far as maintaining health. So we might want to bump that up as far as how we're going to use this information to develop a program. Aerobic capacity, so your VO2 max and your conditioning. Okay, so conditioning is a hot topic right now between strength and conditioning coaches and sport coaches. And conditioning with respect to all of these other adaptations is the easiest and fastest one to achieve. So whenever you're talking about conditioning right now, while we're months and months away from, you know, potentially restarting another hockey season, while it's important to maintain good aerobic capacity just for long-term health, it shouldn't be number one. It should not be priority number one. And obviously, if you look, number one is short to medium length sprints, and that's all anaerobic work. Okay, so the next time you think, okay, I need to go train today, and you're considering going out for a nice long run, I would think again. Okay? And a lot of your conditioning is going to come from playing your own sport. And then the last one is body composition. Everyone still likes at the high elite levels to measure body composition or body fat percentage. While it's an indicator maybe of work ethic and what you've done over the off season to set yourself up for success, it's not an exact science, and obviously it's not really translating to on-ice performance. So I wouldn't put too much thought into that, but if you're doing all these other things, usually the body composition comes with it as long as you're putting the work in. Okay, so what does all this mean, and what should we be considering at the basic level? Let's go to the next slide. Okay, some simple questions to ask ourselves, especially now, right? Or a lot of us, you know, we're going through this during the time of the pandemic with the coronavirus, COVID-19. A lot of us are training at home, or a lot of us are doing guided workouts via Zoom or whatever it might be over the internet. What have you been doing? And does it match up with what we were just talking about? You know, anybody can make a workout hard, but the idea is to make the workout appropriate to performance and getting better at your sport and being healthy. So I think the first question, you know, I'd like to ask as a strength coach is, am I currently healthy and moving well? Okay, if you're healthy and moving well, your answer is yes to this question. The number one responsibility of a strength coach, and really yourself, is to keep it that way. Okay, your primary, we always say a player or a coach's or an official's best ability is availability. If you can't get in the lineup because you're hurt, what good is that? Okay, so make sure you're taking care of yourself and doing things that keep you healthy. The second half of that first question goes along with number two. Are you moving well? Well, that if you're not an experienced professional and you can't evaluate your own movement patterns, well, what is it? How do you feel is number one. Okay, and do you have any pain associated with movement? And if you do, we obviously need to do something about that. So number two, do I have the appropriate movement patterns? When considering what to do in training, the philosophy we like to use is first move well and then move often. Okay, so we've got to be able to move well before we move often. Moving well is going to sustain our health for long-term development. But also, if you can't move well, do you think you're going to be able to get into those positions that we just analyzed with some of the best skaters in the world? Probably not. So you better make sure that you're even able to get into those positions first before we start putting a bunch of load and a bunch of volume on top of that. You never want to put strength on top of dysfunction. Okay, number three, what's my training age? Maybe, you know, some of you watching might be, you know, 17 years old, but if you've never been exposed to appropriate off-ice training, your training age is actually zero. Okay, so how much experience in the weight room or in dry land training do I have? And then let's make choices based upon that training age. Have I learned the basics? And this one's a trick question. Okay, if you've learned the basics, you're going to continue to master those basics forever. And if you haven't learned the basics, then that's ground zero. That's where the foundation all starts. You better learn those basics, master those basics before we start moving to the next one, which is, do I have an appropriate base of strength? Okay, a lot of those performance characteristics as far as off-ice speed and power, those all require an appropriate base of strength to generate power. So let's make sure that we are establishing that base, and that's also going to keep us healthy. Prioritize for performance. So when you're developing your training protocols, are you going back to that last slide? When you're developing those training philosophies, are you doing so in accordance with these on-ice performance characteristics? Okay, that's what it's all about. It's not about looking good, even though it'll come. If you're doing the right things, most athletes have a good look, right? But that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about performance. The whole idea of training is to get better at your performance in your sport of choice. Okay, so if we go back. Okay, what is the minimal effective dose that I can achieve my results? Okay, we want to be cognizant of the amount of volume that we're exposing ourselves to, or the amount of load and volume that we're exposing our bodies to make sure that we are recovering and achieving those power characteristics. Okay, that kind of goes back to that comment we made earlier on, anyone can make a workout hard, but not everyone can make a workout effective and match up with our goals. There, we just said it. Number eight, training should be effective, right? Have a plan, have your goals, make sure that plan matches your goals. Number nine, continue to evaluate and adapt. Okay, some days you might have it, some days you might not. It's, you know, sometimes you have to adapt to make sure that we're not overtraining, make sure we're testing and retesting so that if we do need to make adjustments, if we're not achieving our goals, we can adapt, we can adjust the program, and then the next time we go back to test again, hopefully we're where we should be. Okay, but you got to be able to listen to your body, but also sometimes you got to push through some things too. So make sure you're testing and retesting and making appropriate changes. And number 10, training should be fun and competitive, right? Who wants to go to the gym if they're not enjoying it? And the easiest way to enjoy it is to spend it with quality people, but also make it competitive, right? The weight room can be another way to train your body and your mind for on-ice performance. And you know, as a coach, sometimes that mind, the mental aspect is something we're looking for almost more than any of these physical components. So have fun, work hard, and then we'll leave you. I know this is a long one, but we'll leave you with another highlight clip. And hopefully you've learned some things. Obviously, this one, we could do this one for hours and we can really get into the details. But at least now you've been exposed to some of the common themes, some of the common mechanics associated with those elite level skaters. And now you can start to consider those adaptations and how you're going to achieve those moving forward with your training. So hope you guys learned a lot, and hopefully you enjoyed this one. Make sure you guys subscribe, and we'll leave you with this one.
Russell has it now for the orders, plays it off the boards and out to center. McDavid hustling. McDavid cutting for the net. Upstairs. Far down. Goal. Well, coming into this game, McDavid had scored 27% of the team's goals this season. He just has that ability, and just he throws the afterburners on right here on this bouncing puck.
And that's exactly what we were just talking about, Kevin. This is late in the shift for McDavid. He was in the defensive zone and the offensive zone, came back. And on the transition, look, and everybody's going for a change, not number 97. That's when he puts it into high gear. He's so acute at knowing it.